everybody. This is our third Talkin' Vinyl series, and I'm really excited about having not only a colleague of mine, but a bona fide expert in jazz, in teaching it, writing about it, promoting it for many, many, many years. He's a mentor of mine as well, and today is he's going to talk about a very famous recording, and he's going to illuminate us and enlighten us about this recording, and that was done by Duke Ellington in 1956.
Bring out the LP.
At Newport. And there's quite a backstory to this recording. So
back.
And there's also a story to the back, but we're going to save that for the end. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome Arnold J. Smith to talk about this.
First, the disclaimer. First, I have to thank Jimmy for thinking of me. He came to my house one day, or one night, and saw this sitting on a music stand, where I was told to display it backside, and I'll tell you what that means in a minute, forward. And he looked at it and he said, this is before these events, he looked at it and he said, I have something for you that you can do. And here it is, came to fruition. It's about a year now, right?
Yeah,
about a year. And it is indeed Ellington and Newport. And I forgot there's one I left out. There was Louis Armstrong at Newport in 56. But there's all kinds of stories that came out with this LP. First of all, the LP was the first of its kind from George Wein. The he had an idea to in 1956 to record all of the Newport functions that he thought the public would want to buy. I was recounting with Jimmy there was Ellington at Newport, there was a second Ellington backed with Buck Clayton All-Stars, which went on to have a life of its own, the Buck Clayton All-Stars. And yeah, there it is. And there were others in this series, which is listed on the back of this one, which included, first of all, the Buck Clayton All-Stars were a bunch of people that came from other bands. And Wein put them together, as he still does, as a matter of fact, or his crew still does. Then there was one with Miles Davis and John Coltrane, the first one, as a matter of fact. Then there was Louis Armstrong and Eddie Condon on one LP, and that was rare because it wasn't quite near the end, but they certainly weren't recording anymore. Who else did I say?
Brubeck.
Oh, yeah, the Dave Brubeck Quartet, from which came some of his time changes. Long before Take Five, he was playing around with 4-4 in his left hand and 3-4 in his right hand, and he would just, that's 4-4 beat, it was called a foxtrot in those days, and 3-4 was called a waltz in those days, and he mixed them up. I was a Brubeck did that. And there was somebody else I mentioned.
Jane Cape.
Oh, J&K formed an experimental group. Two trombones and a rhythm section. J.J. Johnson was the legendary bebop trombone player. Not too easy to get around on trombone. I mean, just picture this. It's not a valve trombone like we heard of Duke Ellington, but a slide trombone. Very difficult to get around on playing that trombone. Very, you can imagine. And then Kai Winding, who took the name K because the marketing people thought it would sound better, J and K. And in truth, some of their record jackets, actually, one of them had a calendar and alphabet, and it was a J and a K. You probably have it here. It's a J and a K. And there, instead of the J and the K, was J.J. Johnson and Kai Winding. They went out of print almost immediately. However, the Columbia Record Club, the famed, feared Columbia Record Club, somebody recognized it, issued these or preserved these and sold them through their facilities. That wasn't so easy because the Columbia Record Club sold only mail order.
I would remember.
Yeah, of course you do. Because you paid a price.
Yep.
And then you belonged to the Columbia Record Club.
The
you had to buy
for a penny apiece.
Eventually. But at first you had to pay with high price in those days. I think $4 an LP. Because that's, and if it was in stereo, you had to pay another dollar. So naturally, this poor kid couldn't afford the extra dollar, so all of mine are in mono, these. And eventually they were reissued on CD. They're still available. And they sound beautiful. But there's a story here, too. This LP, that's the Ellington at Newport LP, the one that sold the most and the best. Why? The critics jumped on board pro Duke Ellington, saying Duke Ellington is can no longer be taken for granted. You probably saw that in the flyers. And Wein said to Duke, "You're not going to come on my festival and do nothing but play your medley and say goodnight." In case you don't know what the medley is, it's a 20-minute compendium of all of Duke Ellington's hits, or a great many of Duke Ellington's hits. You probably heard that medley many times in the past, and will again, count on it. So Duke said, "Okay, what do you want?" So Wein said, "Write something special for this festival." Thus came the Newport Jazz Festival Suite. Unbeknownst or unrealized, Duke was taken aback and never wrote a note until he didn't like to fly, until he was taking the train to Newport. Then he started to write. I'm getting this from the Ellington family, with whom I remain friends. They said, "I was writing up until curtain time." And those of you who know that Duke Ellington rarely lies about stuff like that, believe that that's what Duke Ellington did. He wrote up until it was time to go on the stage. That didn't end there. They recorded the Ellington Suite, Newport Jazz Festival Suite. It was terrible. Duke hated it. He hadn't finished it. Those of you who read anything about Duke Ellington, what's the name of his biography?
Music is My Mistress.
Music is My Mistress, thank you. My memory's still good, just short. Phil Woods. So he didn't like it. And he cajoled the other George, Avakian, who was the producer of all of these festival productions, to go back into the studio and re-record it, which they did. They went back into the studio, re-recorded it, and it still sucked, according to Duke Ellington. Why? Because stereo was new at the time. He says, "I want a stereo recording." He had just started to embark on that, no, that's redundant. He embarked on a series which were live recordings in studio. Duke Ellington's stereo concert or whatever he called a few of them. And he liked the way that sounded. He said, "I want it like that." Avakian had no recourse because these are the only recordings he had of Duke Ellington playing the suite, the Newport Jazz Festival suite. So they put it out, and what you heard for all of those first years was a re-recording of Duke Ellington at Newport 56, the legendary Duke Ellington at Newport 56. It was still awful. Then, I'm not sure if Phil Shapp found or Avakian found, George Avakian that is, that Voice of America, where's the Voice of America? You had the Voice of America.
No, I had the V-discs.
No, the V-discs. Had a Voice of America. For those of you who are uninitiated, Voice of America was broadcast across the Straits of Cuba, and they broadcast it all over Europe as an example of American jazz. But it wasn't allowed to be broadcast in the United States. That was the big thing. George Kanzler, late of the Newark Star Ledger, called me the other day and said, and he sent me an email and said that he remembers them being broadcast on something called Monitor Radio. Does anybody remember Monitor? Oh, great.
Well, all weekend.
Oh, it was a weekend program.
Yeah. There was a gag in Playboy, and the Playboy girl with the big tits looking at the whole thing. So he invited me up to his apartment and he said, let's just say till this radio show is over. You ever hear things called Monitor?
Tad, introduce yourself.
Tad Richards, listening to Fresh Tears.
And he'll be here next time.
The 30th.
With Bob Porter.
But yeah, it started like Friday night and went through Sunday night, Monitor Radio on NBC.
Well, anyhow, Kanzler heard the entire broadcast of this particular Newport Festival. I didn't. I have some tapes, of course it was not a very good broadcast. I have some tapes of the Newport Jazz Festival that year, but nothing that I can really, had I known that Jimmy didn't have them, I would have brought them. However, there's another however. We, whoever we are, or they, whoever they are, discovered a VOA, Voice of America, tape of the Newport Jazz Festival 1956. Everybody gasped, "You have that?" So Phil Shapp got his hands on it and put it together on a two CD. You can the two or three CDs, I'm not even sure. CDs of this still sounding bloody awful. Of the Voice of America, which sounded great. Because when it came to the 27, and I'll tell you about that in a minute, choruses by Paul Gonzales, you could actually hear him. You know, has anybody seen, and some of you are probably much too young to have, or maybe you can see video, of the Duke Ellington Band and Paul Gonzales walking the stage, where you can actually hear him go from speaker to speaker on the Voice of America. 27 choruses. Why? Duke was supposed to, the feature of the Duke Ellington concert, and I got this from two Georges and Phil Shapp and the Voice of America person with whom I became friendly. What happened was they broadcast this particular 27 choruses of DNC and Blue. Why? The whole idea behind having Duke on the festival, as I said before, was that Wein had told him, no medley, I want to hear new stuff. I'm sure he didn't use the word stuff. He wanted to hear new material. Duke, of course, hadn't finished writing it, so he didn't have any new material. Now, D&C, Diminuendo in Blue and Crescendo in Blue, had been a staple with the Ellington Band from 1939. He announces this as 1940 on the LP. It was not 1940, it was 1939. So what happened was, Duke, what they did was, what Duke did in the past, was that he played the first part, Diminuendo Blue, by the way, it's reversed, Diminuendo in Blue and Crescendo in Blue. It's the other way around. No, he did it the other way around. And, but he separated each segment. First of all, it was on 78 RPM recordings. So you got one half on one side and one half on the other side. That made the whole D&C in Blue complete. In between what it turned out to be, and Duke called it this, the wailing interval, he did other things, none of which featured Paul Gonzales. It was a tune, maybe something out of his trunk, maybe something he was writing, but it was completely two different sections. He wanted it as two different sections, Duke did. So when he got to Newport, and he didn't have new material, he called upon Paul Gonzales, which is what you hear on here, to play the interval. He calls it the wailing interval, Duke did. And they played it that way, attached. In other words, there was no break. Gonzales came out with his metal mouthpiece and blew 27 choruses without repeating a phrase. Want to play that? Okay. It's a long one. It's a long track, right?
Now we're going to play about 1939. These are separated by an interval by Paul Gonzales.
Man could play the piano. He could play the blues. He loved the blues. Thank you. fun. From the church. Trombone was Monsignor John Sanders, who went into the priesthood after this. He says, only God can follow this. Thank you. one phrase. Sacred concert, he said, after a really high solo like this, he turned to the audience and says, "That's as high as we go."
So, AJ, I have a couple of questions come to mind.
Listen. Oh, only a couple? My goodness, I want more.
a couple of questions come to
mind. I wasn't there.
Bob Porter told me he was there, so we'll get him. We'll pick his brain when he comes on the 30th. But my questions are this: so, what did this recording do for Duke's career at that time after it came out. What did it do to Paul Gonzales' career?
Well, it made Gonzales' career.
And could you tell us a little bit of what we heard on the record and what's on the complete reissue that Phil Schaap did? So the first question is, what did
last
it,
or first?
No, what did it do for Duke's career when this?
First of all, I mentioned that Wein said to Duke, no medley. You know, take the A train and all those other bon mots. So that was out of the question. And this was the year, according to, I think Ira Gitlin, now that he's on everybody's lips, he just passed, said, this is the year we stopped taking Duke Ellington for granted. And it was because of this recording. Now, I mentioned to you that this, no I didn't. This was not supposed to be the feature of this festival. The feature of the festival was supposed to be the Newport Jazz Festival suite, which had, I don't have it does have it here too, but I'm not going to search for it. It had four different movements, the suite, four distinct movements, different rhythms, different tempi, and Duke made sure he played all of them. As I said to you before, or did I? He was not happy. Mm-hmm. I mentioned that already. So he cajoled Avakian into going back into the studio and re-recording the entire festival suite. Not this. As it turns out, the festival suite was supposed to be the big hit of Duke's segment of the festival, But as it turned out, this 1939 vintage, he says 38, this 1939 vintage, Diminuendo in Blue and Crescendo in Blue, an old warhorse from 1938, was the feature of the festival. Not only of Duke's set, but of the entire festival. Pandemonium broke out. This blonde started to dance in the audience. Why was that unusual? This was Newport, Rhode Island. Excuse me, they walked around in the rain, they could have drowned. So it was difficult. But when I put it to Wein, I did a column, you can still bring it up on my blog, called the Octo Jazzarians, those over 80 who are still playing, or were still playing at the time. And I called him and I said, by the way, can I say that that you knew who she was? He says, oh yeah, we even paid her. Now why did we have to pay her? She owned half of Newport, you know. So that was an unusual situation.
Was she a Lorillard?
Yes, as a matter of fact, she was. Lorillard, that's the cigarette.
She was the benefactor of
George of the festival,
of
right.
The festival.
Sorry, thank you. And I knew there were a lot of little things I'm going to leave out. So as far as Wein was concerned, this was a whole new festival for him. Because after this, Duke was on every single festival that Duke produced all over the country. The Duke Band was available. If the Duke Band was available, they played. What did it do for Paul Gonzales? Paul who? Before the solo. Paul Gonzales. Oh, Newport, right. And Duke used to introduce the band in a series called the VIP Boogie. And he'd introduce each soloist. And when he came to Paul Gonzales, he would introduce each person, Russell Prokop from 137th Street and St. Nicholas Avenue, you know, that kind of thing. And he gets to Paul Gonzales and he says, Paul Gonzales, Newport, 1956. I mean, you know, tongue-in-cheek. And Bob Thiel produced an LP on Flying Dutchman called The Wailing Interlude, featuring Paul Gonzales playing this particular solo, broken up into different places. So he, you have that here, Jimmy?
No, I don't.
Oh boy, I got more stuff than he does. But that's what it did for Paul Gonzales. That was a good question. As far as I said to you before, Monsignor John Sanders left the band soon after that because he was ordained. And he was forced, yes, I said forced, to leave the band, otherwise be defunct. As was somebody else. Somebody else also was in the band, and he was asked to, oh yes, oh no, not in the band. Norman O'Connor. Norman O'Connor was what we used to call the jazz priest. He was introduced this one, as you heard, all of these Newport Jazz Festival segments until he was a Paulist, P-A-U-L-I-S-T. And he was asked to stop by the church because it was unseemly that such a religious person should be doing jazz. So that ended his, and he was very astute. I really liked that man. We got along so well. I had some very nice private moments with him.
Didn't Father Norman O'Connor start the series at St. Peter's? Was that him? Or was that a different?
That was a different.
John Gensel.
John Gensel.
Yeah. Pastor, not a reverend. And he and I became friends. Mm-hmm. And we had some really, I remember showing up there one New Year's Eve. And I was there Christmas Eve. And Thanksgiving, I helped serve. And he looked out at the congregation and said, "And there's Arnold J. Smith. If I didn't know better, I thought he was one of ours." And yeah, he and I were very good friends. Very, very good friends. And a mentor to me, too. An advisor. And, there's so much.
The third part of the question was, because you were explaining before we started, that what we hear on the record, the stuff that got from the voice of how the complete Newport Festival came out later.
In 1950, remind me of your question. In 1957, this came out. My parents and our waiter befriended Phyllis Goodstein. Why do I remember that name? Because Oscar Goodstein was the manager of Birdland. I see you're nodding, so you know what I'm talking about.
It's all coming back.
And he managed and kept everybody out of the way of...
Now, wait, you're talking about the original Birdland on 52nd and Broadway.
Broadway near 52nd Street, mm-hmm. Right. Thank you. That's right, there are two other Birdlands subsequent to that. And so I was there. I was a problem child. And I had jazz, and that was keeping me straight, but my parents never knew where I was from moment to moment. And from night to night. Where is he? He's hanging out in Broadway. Why, your son is... And I was diminutive for my age. In other words, too short. But Oscar adopted me. Phyllis had an older sister who took make sure that nobody bothered me. Phyllis and I were in James Madison High School. Madison, wherever loyal.
Brooklyn.
My
and, let's see, who else was in that? Well, Marty Glickman came out of that school, and Bernie Sanders came out of that school, and the Supreme Court Justice...
Gene Norman.
Gene Norman came... Oh, that's right, Gene Norman, that's right.
He told me
when he moved When he moved, before he moved to California?
Before he moved, he's from Brooklyn. He's a Brooklyn guy.
And the Supreme Court Justice came out of Madison. And anyhow, so I would go to Birdland as often as possible. When this came out, you know I wasn't going to miss an opportunity like this. They had a private showing, or a private set, Duke did, and invitation only kind of thing. There were two sets. One was Oscar Pettiford, Philly Joe Jones, and the pianist, I think Ahmad Jamal, and the Duke Ellington band. So I just had my album from the Columbia Record Club and went down to Birdland. It was Oscar at the door, and he waved me in. Long line, angry people waving this little kid in, wasn't even old enough to get into the club, right?
Let me just quickly interrupt you. When you were going to Birdland, was Pee Wee Marquette still working the door?
Oh, you want me to talk about Pee Wee Marquette?
No, I want you to
talk about Pee Wee Marquette. Pee Wee Marquette was what Lester Young called a half a motherfucker. He was a midget. It was about that big. Had a foul mouth on him. And if you crossed his palm with silver, he would pronounce your name properly. Otherwise, you became Art Blakely. I can't think of some of the other names, but they were awfully foul. We used to boo him all the time. But yeah, I was there when the midget was there. The half a mother was there. Yeah, right. I didn't invent that. It was Prez. And he had a language all his own anyhow. Yeah. Everybody was miss this and miss that. And you got out of Prez's way when he finished and he wasn't getting the right applause. You didn't want to be around him. He was not nasty, but just doer. That's the right word. D-O-U-R. Doer. And... so anyhow, I got to the bandstand, and I started to. I said, "Why don't I get the whole to myself? Of course, why don't I get the whole band to sign my album?" Ladies and gentlemen, there it is. The signed. Yeah, he took that. The signed album. No, I'm not going to pass it around.
Including Duke.
Duke is plastered, brother. Duke is, I think, you see that big, see
hold
that?
Hold it up, AJ.
You see that thing over there?
That's Duke. And like Paul? That. And Paul the star?
Paul Gonzales was, I just saw his name. He signed under somebody else. Oh, here it is. Good luck from, I can't read, but he was, that's Paul Gonzales over there. My favorite people were on this band. Cat Anderson, he was spectacular. Getting up there with all those high notes. He really spackled.
Did someone draw an illustration on the back?
Clark Terry. There's Clark Terry, and it became his permanent signature. He would draw a trumpet.
Wow.
And I believe, if I'm not much mistaken, you can come up and look at it, but I'm not, I'm going to be here slapping your hand if you touch it. The bass player, Jimmy Woody, from Philadelphia, went on to some great things. Drew a bass, but maybe on a different album, because I can't find it here. Anyhow, I'll leave it like this, but don't touch it, please. My brother called me, he's a saxophone player, my brother called me and said, make sure they don't touch your LP. Phil Schaff told me the bidding should start at $20,000.
Wow.
But I don't think so. I don't think so. Unless somebody has very deep pockets. And even then, what am I going to do with $20,000?
Yeah. You can share it.
Yawn. I'll give it to Jimmy so he can sell some.
It's like a buy Phil's
some collection. Of my LPs. The what?
Buy Phil's collection.
Yeah, buy Phil's collection. That's right. What else? You had another.
My other question was you explaining how the
the voice of America.
Yeah, explaining how what Phil Shapp released came about. That's a fascinating.
He was looking for. Shapp never stops looking for stuff. And he was looking for something other than these terrible recordings, as you've heard. It was a very bad recording. That didn't turn up. This is 2019. That had to be somewhere earlier this century when he discovered that Voice of America had the recording and could give it to us to listen to. It had to be both ways. Of course, Voice of America is not around anymore. But when I went to Cuba in 1977, we took that cruise to Cuba. You may have read about it. And when I went to Cuba, all they could talk about was Willis Conover. How did you hear about it? I would walk around with a microphone. How did you hear about jazz? Where did you copy it from? Where did you copy it from? Paquito, who remains an excellent close friend of mine, and Arturo Sandoval, and Chucho Valdez. Those are the three biggies. And they all said the same thing, whether they were together or individually. Willis Conover, the broadcast from Voice of America to over the Straits of Cuba. And I heard some of those tapes. I've got some of those tapes. So when Phil found out not only that they were available, but that they could be shared, they could be broadcast or whatever, he went out and got and issued the complete Ellington at Newport, which included all of this, plus, and this is one of my favorite moments, the opening track is the Star Spangled Banner by the Duke Ellington Orchestra. One of my favorite, and if I had known Jimmy didn't have it, well, he'll have to ask me back. I've got them. And I've got those Voice of Americas. Now, Phil Shapp did other things. I seem to be a pain to Phil today. We all know about the 1938 Carnegie Hall Jazz Concert. Penny Goodman. He found tapes, again, from Voice of America and issued a new version of the 1938 Carnegie Hall Jazz Concert. I called him up, castigated him for even thinking to reissue those. They are just bloody awful. They are analog. They are not stereo. But I have recordings. Well, we're getting into a tangent. My drummer's uncle was a famous drummer, recording drummer by the name of Terry Snyder. You remember Yellow Rose of Texas? Mitch Miller? He was the drummer on that. Terry Snyder, among other things. And so what happened was I had a version from his tapes. I used those tapes plus Phil's rediscovery of some of the other stuff that was left off the original LPs. It was LPs, two LPs. And that's the version I have on DVD. No, on CD.
CD.
On CD. So, Jimmy, you'll have to ask me back and I'll bring all of this.
We'll have to have a part two, so... I'm going to Las Vegas to Pawn Stars.
You're and I'll take it out with you.
AJ, thank you for
my pleasure. Questions.
Any questions from anybody?
By all means, go ahead.
Now, on this new double CD set, did they the whole original album and then the Voice of America version with the additional?
Very good question.
Okay.
Both versions are on this double CD. This version and the complete version. So it's four sides. Don't forget, you can put up to 80 minutes.
Yeah, on a CD, yeah.
Yeah. So both versions are on there, including the Star Spangled Banner, mm-hmm. including other stuff that was taken off. There's, on the Benny Goodman, there's a track that is in such bad shape on one of Benny's big hits called Sometimes I'm Happy, which is on that LP. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, on that CD, thanks to me. It's not available otherwise.
Another thing, the only studio remake was of the Suite, or
as near. I'm sorry.
Yeah. That's what I want to. Because I thought D&C was remade, but no, that's the original live.
All right. Wait. Yeah, that was the original one.
Because George Avakian does great things with crowd noises.
Oh.
He's unbelievable.
You can't tell the difference.
No, you can't. I know.
But both Georges told me. And it has to be true because it's almost the same story. That they went back into the studio and re-recorded the entire concert. The entire concert. Yeah. Except the D&C.
Oh, okay.
Because they knew they couldn't recapture it.
Okay. That answers it. Okay.
So they didn't do that. But there is so much more on that recording. Black and Tan Fantasy. Where is it? Where's here? This? Is this on here? No.
That's the V-discs from the 30s.
Right. What was I looking at before? Your.
We had the discography.
The discography on there. Jimmy's got the whole discography.
Was this concert, was this the closing night concert or the opening night?
There was only one.
There was just one night.
Just one concert.
So it's 6 and 7 on the back. It says Newport Jazz Festival, July 6 and 7.
I don't know of any, let's put it that way. As near as both Georges have told me, I don't know of any. As near as far as Duke is concerned, and of course he's very close now. Well, now he's close now, period. but he was very close mouth about giving away any secrets, as you probably know. He would give you that Mona Lisa smile.
The other question I had for you was, I don't know if people know this or not, but when George Wein sold Festival Productions, right? And as part of it, all the recordings were sold to Wolfgang's Vault. If you heard, people know what Wolfgang's Vault is? It's just...
Bring it up, Volkswagenvault.com.
You go, just go Google Wolfgang's Vault, and it's just an amazing website. He bought Bill Graham's archive, too, so concerts that you may have attended at the Fillmore East or Fillmore West. It's amazing what's in there. And Wolfgang bought George Wein's archive, and you could go in there and...
What's his last name?
I don't remember
that. I forgot.
Anyway, it's extraordinary. It's a treasure trove of live stuff from since we're talking of Newport.
You can stream them?
You could absolutely stream just them, buy them, download them.
Sign on with your name and you're a permanent member.
It's amazing what's in there. And I'm curious, now that we're talking about it, I just thought about it. I wonder if that was part of it.
I don't know. I do know that this is the only
Is that a vintage hoodie from
That's
Newport?
A vintage
what
hoodie
year is that?
From a place called Cuffy's.
Cuffy's?
Cuffy's in Boston, and they opened up in the summertime. They opened up in Newport. No more. They got a business. And this is the only haberdashery I have. When is this from? 2000? Yeah, 2000. Charlie Gans and I, Charlie Gans of Associated Press. We still go up to Newport every year. But this came from...
I know you still go because...
We see you all the time.
I bumped into you at Flo's Clam Shack.
Flo's, yes, indeed.
In Newport. for best lobster rolls in Newport.
This is from the statue.
Up on the
110th Street.
110th Street and Broadway.
Fifth Avenue.
Is it Fifth? I thought it was. Fifth Avenue, right. Duke Ellington Boulevard.
We're at 106th Street.
106th.
Yeah. This is 110th. I'll get it. Stick with me. We'll get it to you. So I thought I'd wear this because I don't get a chance to wear this except on his birthday. April 29th, which also happens to be the date of my latest marriage. And why? On purpose. I said to Fran, who's a singer, I said to her, when do you want to get married? She said, I don't know, pick a date. I said, April 29th, Duke Ellington's 99th birthday.
So that's my anniversary, too.
April 29th?
April 29th.
All right.
1994.
We did much the same thing. We picked Pearl Harbor Day. Yes.
On purpose.
Then we'll live in infamy.
Yes. FDR. Well,
AJ, we're at the 5 o'clock hour. And if
I can go on forever.
I know you can, but we only have an hour. And I want to thank you for your talk today. And I just want to remind everybody that, Tad, why don't you just stand up? Tad Richards is here. And I want to introduce everybody to Tad. And Tad is going to be speaking with Bob Porter. He is the creator of Listening to Prestige blog. And if you don't know it, Google it and check it out. It's absolutely fantastic. And Todd will be speaking here on Sunday, the 30th of June. So mark your calendars. And thanks, everybody, for coming. Thank you, AJ.
My pleasure.
You can go on forever.
You can come up and look at it.
Part two.
Just don't touch it.